I'd like to thank the ICE for inviting me to, and Rob for inviting me to give this talk today, and I'd like to thank Jean for doing a great job of the introduction. Jean and I share in common that early in our careers we were mentored by Rob Page, and so he's been instrumental to both of us. And in that vein, with the title of the talk is The Spirit of the Hive, and that is to remember that Rob wrote a great book that you should read on the spirit of the hive. But then I've changed it a little bit, and we're going to talk about socio-complexity to social evolution, because that's sort of my take on what Rob taught me way back, not that long ago, but pretty long ago. All right, so when we think of social insects, we always have to start with this beautiful examples of social complexity. We have a few exemplars here. We have the army ants that bridge to get from one space to the other. We have honeybees that form clusters and actually have decision making as a collective in terms of house hunting. We have a couple of examples of beautiful architecture that is designed by self-organization, and I just want to put a plug, actually, for a symposium. If you guys are interested in these kinds of things, that there's going to be a symposium looking at this beautiful architecture with equally beautiful equations to explain them. And I will not have those beautiful equations in this talk, and you'll probably thank me for that. All right. But they remind us that insect societies and social insect societies are complex adaptive systems. What this means is that they're distributed networks, that the groups have a local coordination, not a central controller, not someone telling everybody what to do, but behavioral interactions among individuals in the group generate nonlinear emergent outcomes. These outcomes are nonlinear because they're produced by positive feedback loops. One individual does something, another individual does more, another individual does more, and so on and so forth, till you get some kind of cascade effect. That cascade effect generates what we call self-organization, and the outcomes are the emergent properties. And we think about this in terms of social insects quite a lot. For example, the beautiful honeycomb that is produced there. But in the lecture today, I want to sort of take us outside of the eusocial, very adaptive derived groups, and think about how these kinds of principles might affect social organization more broadly. Because eusociality isn't the only form of sociality, of course, that you get in insects. We have the eusocial bees, but we also have eusocial insects that come about eusociality in a different way. We have aggregations, large groups of individuals that come together. They may not cooperate very much, but they might show coordinated behavior. And then we have some of my favorite groups. These are the communally cooperative groups, and I threw a spider in there. I know it's not an insect, but it is communally cooperative in this case. These are societies where you have individuals, all of whom reproduce, so that the costs and benefits of these kinds of dynamical effects are different for different individuals in the group. And this generates an intricacy between the self-organizational properties and what happens in terms of social evolution. So they're particularly interesting. So one of the things that we can think about in terms of self-organization is not just, well, how is it adaptive in a large group, but also how do groups of individuals transform into a society, and how do those complexity components contribute to it? So I can introduce another term here, social dynamics. And social dynamics are basically self-organization, but we can start thinking about it in terms of the nonlinear effects of social interactions. What happens when individuals start interacting with each other? How does it shape individual and group level phenotypes? And how does that affect fitness outcomes for the individual and for the group as a whole? So in the talk today, I'm going to address this in two different social forms. First of all, I'm going to think about how social dynamics influence these transition to cooperative sociality. And then I'm going to go back to the eusocial colony because they are important and they are beautiful. And I'm going to talk a little bit about how social dynamics scale in eusocial colonies. Now, on the first question, so if you get to like 40 minutes and you start to get really worried, don't worry, there's only a taste of the second question in here, and we will get out in time, I hope. All right. So social dynamics involve feedback loops, as I've already sort of mentioned, and these positive feedback loops generate changes in the way individuals behave. I like to divide these decisions into two different kinds of effects. The first is that these feedback loops generate an increased probability of other individuals doing the same thing. We see this a lot in collective decision making. We see it in recruitment. For example, in the ant picture here, where we have individuals that are laying pheromone on one trail versus the other, that increases and increases and increases and amplifies the probability that the ants will go in one direction versus the other direction. Some beautiful work done by Jean-Louis Denoborg's group. And an extreme example of that is in the Africanized honeybees, where individuals respond to a pheromone by alarming, put out more pheromone, and you get a cascade effect where within seconds you're surrounded by a cloud of bees. And that's a picture from my lab, and we don't even know who was in the soup by the time the bees were finished attacking. There's also, though, the amplifying effect of positive feedback in conflict escalation. Not to make a socio or political statement, but when individuals start responding to aggression with more aggression, you get the amplification of aggressive behaviors. We see this in ants quite a lot. We see this in incipient social groups. And one of the key questions in social transitions is how do you damp down those effects so that you can get tolerance in a group? We also get positive feedback loops generating differentiation between individuals. How do individuals end up doing different things? So in dominance relationships, when you have battles, one individual is more likely to win, the other individual is more likely to lose, and that shapes their behavior in successive interactions, and so you can get the emergence of dominance. That's very relevant to reproductive division of labor or reproductive skew. I want to, though, focus on a different kind of division of labor, and that's the division of labor that happens in your daily life as you have to decide what to do in terms of getting food, taking care of your offspring, keeping your nest clean, defending against predators, all of those daily things that have to happen in order for you to survive, to maintain, and to grow as a social group. That kind of division of labor is involves individuals differentiating towards performing different tasks in the group. So not just reproductive division of labor, but division of labor for work, basically. So the question we can ask is, how can this kind of division of labor self-organize? How can you get the emergence of specialization within a social group? And the major model for this, and that was actually first developed by Jean and by Rob heuristically, and then it's been mathematically explained and expanded by Bonobo's group and Terralaz and other people that have written some beautiful models on it, basically makes a simple assumption. It makes the assumption that you have an intrinsic set point. There's a point at which you notice a task. And that set point is reached when the external stimulus for that task increases beyond the set point. At that point, you're more likely to perform that task. You can model it mathematically in an equation where the threshold or the probability of responding is related to the stimulus divided by the stimulus and your threshold, and then you will increase your probability of performing a task as stimulus levels increase. And you can do this for different individuals within a group. Variation will generate different individuals differentiating into different tasks. Rob's worked on this idea for a large chunk of what he's done, and he's focused on the physiological and genetic pathways to task decisions. He's actually shown that there are physiological pathways to differences in task sensitivity, and he's also shown that response thresholds have a genetic basis. And with some work that I was lucky to do with him, he's shown that genetic variation can enhance division of labor in used social insect colonies. So this genetic variation and the response threshold model contribute to a colony being able to adaptively change task allocation as the need for tasks changes. But I want to take a different route because we want to think about how this kind of model might affect the emergence of division of labor in different social groups. And what I'm really interested in talking about right at the beginning is what happens at the transition from solitary to social. what happens when you take a group of individuals who will vary in their response thresholds just because there is a variation in among individuals, and you put them together. So you imagine that individuals respond to stimuli according to their internal response threshold, right? And you imagine that stimulus for a task will increase until it's performed. And as an illustration, we have dishes in a sink, right? As individuals come into the group, they all use dishes. They all put dishes in the sink, but not all of them notice the dishes in the sink. Some individuals will have high thresholds. It's not their fault. They might have been born with it. And they will walk past the dishes until they reach a significant level, at which point those individuals will perform the task. But other individuals are very sensitive to the number of dishes in the sink. And even with a few dishes in the sink, they will start to wash the dishes. And when they wash the dishes, they remove the task stimulus from the other individuals. So it's not your fault if you don't wash the dishes. If there's a take-home message on this, this is it. It's not your fault. It's the dishwasher's fault, right? But hopefully, in a group where you have differences in task thresholds for different tasks, another individual will take over a different task and you'll have division of labor so that all the housework gets done, or the nest work in the case of a social insect colony. All right. The point being, though, that you can get the emergence of a task specialist just from these simple rules of behavior that you put together with social interactions, right? So if that's the case, you should see the spontaneous emergence of division of labor across social groups, and you should see it before selection has acted on sociality. So the next question becomes, can you get division of labor or task specialization if you create groups of normally solitary individuals? What happens when you put solitary individuals together? Do you see them do different tasks? And we've asked that question in a couple of different systems in my lab. Probably the most foundational one for the question of the transition between solitary and cooperative is in the lazy aglossum or the sweat bees, where we've taken completely solitary bees with no phylogenetic history of eusociality, put them together, and we get a division of labor between different tasks, mostly between guarding and excavating. The other system that we've used, kind of ironically, is the harvester ants, which are eusocial ants that are common to the deserts of the southwest United States. They have beautiful large colonies with workers, but at the beginning of the colony life cycle is a single queen who excavates a nest, and she does so by herself. We can actually put those queens together, and we can look at what happens, and in all of those cases, we get an emergent division of labor. So the answer to the question is, do they specialize? It's yes, they do. They specialize in different tasks. Today, I'm not going to show you the bee data, although they're very interesting. I'm going to focus on the ants because I want to take us through the life cycle of the colony. So we're going to start with a Pogona myrmex barbatus mating flight, just to get you oriented to these ants. These are, as I said, they're common in the desert southwest. This is a colony that's getting ready to throw its alates out into the air. The queens and the males will go up into the air. They'll mate with each other. They mate multiply. And then the queens land on the ground, they chew off their wings, and they excavate a nest. And at that point, in this species, they're solitary. It's excavators, it's the ancestral condition, and it's the norm for this species. That's a beautiful shot from Elizabeth Cash there of the flight of the wee Barbatus. All right, so this is what we do. We walk along, we pick these queens up right after they've mated. We bring them into the colony, and it's a very manipulable system. You can put them into observation nests. You can put hundreds of observation nests into the lab, and then you can sit there and you can watch what they do. So here we have naive ants. They've just been picked up from the ground. They haven't excavated yet. We put them in nests together. And what we find immediately in these systems is that they actually vary in excavation rates. One of the individuals excavates more, the other one excavates less, and we can call them HFE, LFE, high frequency, and low frequency excavators. We can then identify them as such and put them into different associations. We put them into associations where, there we go. where we have an HFE with an LFE, but they're in different social pairs. They're with a different ant. But we can also take two individuals that excavated more before and put them together, see what happens, and two individuals that didn't excavate in their last association, put them together, see what happens, right? If division of labor emerges, we should see division of labor, we should see task specialization across the board in all of these. If it's just variation, then we'll just see the same variation as we saw before. And here are some data for it. The first bar shows you the initial pairs. The orange is the high-frequency excavator. The blue is the low-frequency excavator. And as you can see, they differentiate. It's not just that one digs more than the other. There's actually an interaction effect. The one that doesn't dig very much at all. When you look at two high-frequency excavators that you've put together in the next bar, the one that excavated, one of them excavates and the other one doesn't. So one of them changes her behavior to reduce her excavation relative to what she did before because she's in a new social group. And interestingly, and this is important to those dishwasher concerned people out there, is if you put two low frequency excavators together, one of them takes over the task, right? So in analogy, the dishes will get done, okay? They'll get done, right? And if you put a high and a low frequency excavator together, you get, again, the emergence of a pattern with one individual excavating the other one not. And it's usually, almost always, the same individual that's the high frequency excavator. So it's based on some intrinsic property of the individuals, but what they do in a social group changes depending on the social context that you put them in, right? Okay. So the other interesting thing that we got from this experiment that we did at the beginning of our explorations into the emergence of division of labor was that emergent task specialization influences fitness. So what we found was that we didn't just get the emergence of differences in behavior, we also got the emergence of differences in cost. So there are cost disparities associated with these interaction effects. Basically, in this system, if you excavate, you abrade your cuticle. And when you abrade your cuticle, you're subject to water loss. And what we found was when in those situations where we had a consistently high a difference between high and low frequency excavators, so not the situations where we put two HFEs together, et cetera, we got higher survival for the low frequency excavator relative to the high frequency excavator. So this is important because this means that at the origin of sociality in a cooperative system where both individuals want to survive and both individuals want to go on to reproduction, you have already an imbalance in fitness tokens, right? One individual is more likely to survive than the other. And that imbalance is based on the social group. So an individual is likely to survive or to die depending on the other queen that we put her with. And therefore, the phenotype and survival of any given queen is dependent on social dynamics. So it happens right at the origins of sociality. And if we think about models of social evolution, we need to take these kinds of social dynamics into account. So let's think about how we transition to cooperative sociality. And I just want to think a little bit about the kinds of models that we use to explore the evolution of cooperation. I mean, we can think about cooperation in terms of the external drivers or the ecological drivers that contribute to whether or not you're cooperative. Is it easier to get food if you hunt in a group? Is it easier to protect your young? Is it easier to excavate a safe environment? Is it easier to thermoregulate if you're part of a group? All of those ecological factors are important in deciding whether or not a given species is going to get a costs or benefits from being in a social group. But there are also the internal factors that affect sociality, right? How do the social dynamics within that group that are inherent to those groups across ecological conditions, how do they affect the evolution of sociality? So the theoretical expectations for the evolution of cooperation versus non-cooperation, which I'm going to translate into cooperative sociality versus solitary, are pretty standard. There's a lot of different models for it, but they basically make the same generally implicit assumption. And that's that cooperative pairs do better than other forms of sociality. So if you have two individuals who are cooperating, the group outcome is better than would be if you had mixed pairs or if you had pairs of non-cooperators, right? But within a mixed group where you have a cooperator and a non-cooperator, the non-cooperator should have an advantage over the cooperator. The non-cooperator does better. This generates cost disparities, and this generates a barrier to the evolution of social cooperation. This has been a problem for models for the evolution of social cooperation for a long time. It's hard to find systems where you can actually empirically dissect these kinds of costs and benefits, but it turns out that the founders' associations are a good one, and that's because, we have species where we have populations of harvester ants where queens excavate solitarily, just like we've described for Barbados. And then we have other populations where the queens form cooperative associations. So I don't know if you can see in this picture, but we have a nest here with two queens. This doesn't really work very well, but you can probably see them there. Two queens in a nest of harvester ants. These queens excavate together, they form the nest together, and they stay together throughout the lifespan of the colony. So these are polygynous colonies with multiple queens in them from colony founding through colony reproduction. This is a nice system then because we actually have two different social strategies. We have what I'll call haplometrosis, which is colony founding by a single queen, and then we have the strategy of pleometrosis, which is multiple queen founding, which in these colonies turns into primary polygyny, which is cooperative groups of unrelated queens. And I should mention that the queens are unrelated in these systems. And so anytime you see a P, you know that it's cooperative, because it's pleometrotic, primary polygyny, P, cooperative, which makes a lot of sense, I'm sure. Anyway, these strategies in our population, which we examine in San Diego County, California, co-occur at the same time. They all fly and mate at the same time. And we have adjacent populations, some of which are almost all polygynous, some of which are almost all single queen colonies, and we even have some populations where you have a mix of the two. We've done data from, and I should give credit to Jürgen Gadow for these data, we've done some transcriptome work on these populations, and if you see the blue and the red in this diagram, you can see that the populations diverge slightly in their brain gene expression patterns, suggesting that these are genetically different strategies, but there's quite a lot of overlap also in the two different systems. So we're not looking at two different species. We're looking at two different strategies that co-occur, but occur more in one population, and the other one occurs more in the other population, which sets it up very nicely for these kinds of experiments, because you can bring them into the lab, you can do common garden experiments, and then you can ask how do things differ, and what are the consequences of that. So we go back to our simple protocol. I'm a behaviorist, and we like simple behavioral protocols. We pick up the queens, we put them into nests, and we put them in different pairing groups. And now, because we have haplometrotic and pleometrotic queens, we can mix and match them a little bit. So we can put two haplometrotic queens together, we can put two pleometrotic queens together, or we could put a haplometrotic queen with a pleometrotic queen and ask what happens then. Right? We can also put them by themselves, which is unusual but useful because we can say, well, what is the advantage of being in a social group relative to just doing this by yourself? Because we know that these queens can excavate nests and initiate colonies by themselves. And we can look at a lot of different behavioral parameters, and today I'm just going to talk about aggression, which we've talked about a little bit in terms of positive feedback loops, and also task specialization, of course. And then we can look at fitness tokens. The one that we'll just look at today is queen survival, but we can also get information about brood production, colony growth, et cetera. Okay, so here's a nest. They dig this kind of characteristic nest pattern. It's very cute and elegant, and I like it. And you can see two queens here, I think, right? One at the bottom who's got a dot of white paint on, and she's excavating. One at the top, she's actually getting food, and there's a little brood pile over in the corner, and these guys are happily excavating a nest and founding a colony together. All right, nest 113, good nest. Okay, so the first question we want to ask is, well, who performs what task? Remember that we got the emergence of division of labor and that we had a cost associated with the emergence of specialization on excavation. So we can look at these different groups and we can say, well, who excavates, who doesn't excavate? Do you see the emergence of task specialization and what are the consequences? And I think you guys can see this graph. The first set of bars is the haplometrotic queens, and you can see that they differentiate into one individual is more likely to excavate, the other individual is more likely to do brood care. We see differentiation in the pleometrotic pairs as well, but I think that the last bars, the mixed pairs, are the most interesting. And these are some work done by Raphael Janson as a postdoc. He did a lot of the solitary bees work also, so I want to give a shout out to him because he did some really nice work. What you see in the mixed pairs is that you get the differentiation of a brood care specialist and an excavation specialist, but interestingly, the haplometrotic queen ends up as the excavation specialist, and the pleometrotic, aka cooperative queen, ends up as the individual who's taking care of the brood. Now, this generates the potential for cost disparities in which the cooperative queen actually has an advantage over the quote-unquote non-cooperative queen because she gets the easier task. So what's happening here at the division between these evolved social queens and the not evolved social queens isn't that the non-cooperative queen is a cheater. It's that the cooperative queen is policing what happens. She's paying attention to the social group, and she's taking over the task that is the less costly task. She's very interested in the brood, not so interested in digging the nest. That's okay because the other queen is taking care of it for her. So this sort of shifts the way we think about cooperation and the transition to sociality, because cheating is actually a social strategy. You have to come from a history of social evolution in order to be a cheater, right? If you're going to think of it as a strategy. At the origins of sociality, queens aren't cheaters per se in terms of a deliberate strategy. These queens are naive when they come into the social group, which is interesting. Okay. Let's look at this other behavioral context that sort of started to emerge as a pattern as we did these nest experiments over and over and over again. We started to see a specific pattern in the emergence of conflict within these social groups. So in the dynamics of aggression in these pleometrotic and haplometrotic groups, when you put two queens together, you start out in a nest with two queens that are interacting with each other. They're laying eggs, and they're antennating each other, and everything looks good. But at some point in that social dynamic, one of those queens is likely to go up to the other queen and do what is essentially a dominance behavior. She's going to get on top of the other queen, and she's going to start chewing at her a little bit. When that happens, the non-aggressive response is for that other queen to stay still, not respond. And then usually that behavior stops, they move apart, and they come back together again. And what you see is sort of a slight a bit of pre-aggression behavior, but not actual aggression itself. And this is what we see very commonly in our pleometrotic pairs. One queen might do this, the other queen freezes, and then they go on to their tasks. If another possibility occurs, this occurs both in pleometrotic queens and haplometrotic queens, but much more likely in the haplometrotic queens. And that is that queen does not like the behavior, and she turns and she does a defensive C posture. She's basically responding aggressively to an aggressive signal. When this happens, it amplifies. They start to fight with each other. You get one maneuvering, the other one maneuvering in a wrestling position. And usually one dismembers the other one. So these fights are, when they escalate, are extremely aggressive, and they usually end with the mortality of one or both queens. Basically, it's a positive feedback loop. If you respond more aggressively, the other individual acts more aggressively, and you get the escalation of conflict. So what we found when we looked at the haplometrotic versus pleometrotic pairs is that these escalation events happen much more frequently in the haplometrotic pairs than the pleometrotic pairs. Now, they're still not the norm. Most of the pairs don't do this, but you get enough of an escalation in the haplometrotic pairs that it makes a difference to the social dynamic. And here's another data set showing you the haplometrotic pairs, pleometrotic pairs, and the mixed pairs, and the dark gray are the cases in which two queens in the nest acted aggressively. The light gray is just one queen acting aggressively. And you can see that in the pleometrotic pairs and even in the mixed pairs, when there's a pleometrotic queen, usually it's only one queen that behaves aggressively. But in the haplometrotic pairs, there's a responsiveness and both queens start to act aggressively, and then you get these fights. There's two things to consider in this. One is that, first of all, aggression is linked to mortality. So when you get these two queen fights, you're going to get an individual that dies. The second thing to keep in mind, though, is that the aggressor wins 60% of the time. So in that kind of context, you're a little better off if you're the individual that instigates the fight rather than the one that responds to it. So keep that in mind in your social interactions. All right. If we put this all together, we sort of have this now a pattern where we think about how we need to map social traits onto selection outcomes. And instead of just thinking about these as fixed characteristics that might compete with each other, we need to start using social selection models which take these things into account. So you can start with a lineage, a focal lineage of an individual, and you can say, well, what are the genes or the genetic basis to that individual's behavioral characteristics? How does the environment affect that in terms of generating a fitness outcome for it? So that would be the top line. But now you need to also think about, well, it's in a social group. So in addition to that, what is the lineage of the social of its social partners? How does that affect their characteristics? What is the interaction term between them and the focal individual in terms of those social dynamics? That's where that comes in there with the psi term. And then how does it affect their fitness outcomes as well? And what is their resulting fitness? So you can think about this in terms of the fitness of the individuals, the fitness of the group, but you have to think about these in terms of interacting genetic effects. All right. So the phenotype and fitness of any group member depends on the other group members. That's sort of the take-home message here. We can actually go back to our queens and look a little bit at their survival data to see whether or not that is relevant to what we've got in our groups. So here we have data for queens over 50 days. We choose 50 days because that's when you get the emergence of the first workers, and these founders' associations actually turn into colonies. The top line in orange is survival of queens in pleometrotic pairs, and as expected, they do well. A pleometrotic queen does well when you put her with another queen. The haplometrotic queens do not do as well in pairs with each other. They don't coordinate very well, and they also have aggression, and so they have a lower survival rate. Interestingly, I think this is sort of the most interesting part of these data, the pairs that are haplometrotic with a pleometrotic queen are intermediate. They're not as good as pleometrotic pairs. They're not as bad as haplometrotic pairs. And the haplometrotic or pleometrotic queen is equally likely to survive in these pairs. There's not a difference between the two types when you put them into a mixed social group. So it doesn't actually fit the model that the non-cooperator is going to outcompete the cooperator. They actually both do well, and that's probably because there's a lot of different social dynamics from division of labor through aggression going on simultaneously in the group. Another interesting thing about the whole thing is that they don't do any better or any worse when they're in mixed pairs than if they're by themselves. So if you put a pleometrotic queen with a haplometrotic queen, you might as well have put her in the nest by herself. If you put a haplometrotic queen with a pleometrotic queen, same thing. So there's not a benefit or cost relative to being by yourself in that sense. The benefits come when you put individuals of the same type together if they're pleometrotic, and the cost as well. All right, so what this boils down to as a take-home message is, this is not necessarily a Game of Thrones. You can, in the right circumstances, survive together as two queens in a nest, generate a kingdom of workers that are happily working for you, and be harmonious, so to speak. Anyway, so now we've got sort of this picture of the origins of social evolution. I want to spend the last bit of the talk turning to these eusocial colonies, because these are really interesting colonies. And you can grow an ant colony, unlike a bee colony, just a shout out there, from a single individual or two queens into a group of thousands of individuals. And you can look at how the organization of the colony, how the organization of work is shaped as you grow from a few individuals to many. And that's sort of a fascinating question in itself. So remembering that these are now eusocial systems, that when we look at the behavior of the workers, we're looking at a group of individuals, all of whom are working towards a common goal, right, which is the productivity of the colony. So with that, we can ask, well, let's take our emergent division of labor models and ask, how does this affect colony scaling? This is work done by Tate Holbrook in my lab, and I hear Tate's here, so hi, Tate, if I see him. He did some really elegant work dissecting out the effect of colony size on division of labor. He did it in colonies of different sizes at the same age, different, and colonies as they grew from a few individuals to a lot of individuals. And he got a consistent result in that division of labor scales with colony size. As you increase colony size, you increase the level of specialization that you see in workers. And this outcome is actually predicted by emergent models of division of labor. Basically, as you increase group size, there are a few different emergent effects that can happen that generate an expectation of increased division of labor. First of all, as you increase the number of individuals, you should increase variance in response thresholds. With the addition of a self-reinforcement component, where individuals are more likely to perform a task if they've already performed that task, this can really drive the increase in division of labor in a group as you increase the number of individuals. Second of all, when you increase group size, you don't increase the number of tasks the same way as you increase the number of individuals performing the task. So you get redundancy. Individuals essentially compete for a task when you get redundancy, especially if there are more workers present than needed for the task. And if you think about the work that's been presented recently by Anna Dornhaus and Dan Charbonneau, showing that in most social in many social insect colonies, there's usually a large number of individuals that are not working at any given time. This suggests that those conditions are correct for the expectation that division of labor should increase with group size. It's hard, though, to go into these systems and dissect out the effects of these emergent properties on division of labor relative to what else is going on in the colony, because these are highly functional regulated units. And that makes them hard to dissect, but really interesting. So we can't just use an emergent argument for the scaling of division of labor in these groups. There are other things going on. There are other regulatory changes. And just to highlight some of those, we have demographic changes, right? So as colonies get bigger, worker size changes so that you get a higher variation in individual worker size. You get an increase or you get more variation in worker age. And we know, although I'm not going to show you the data for it, that individuals change, not only change their behaviors as they get older, as the age polyethism model suggests, but they also expand their task repertoires as they get older. There's also an increase in genetic diversity in the colonies. If you had genetic variation, you add more individuals to a population, you're going to get a wider range in terms of variance. And in the highly derived eusocial insects, you even get such incredible morphological variation that you get actual physical casts. That doesn't happen in the harvester ants, but you do get a significant change in body size. In addition to that, though, colonies actively reallocate their tasks as they change in size, depending on what they need to do. So colonies should, when they're small, allocate a lot of their investment to growth of larvae and to increase brood production. And as they get larger, shift towards more of an emphasis on tasks that maintain the colony. Not that one should override the other, but you should just see a proportional shift in these two different task groups. And we actually see that in our harvester ant colonies. Colonies that are smaller are more likely to do brood care, and you get a negative relationship between colony size and performance of brood care, and a positive relationship between colony size and the performance of sanitation or trash maintenance and other maintenance tasks. And this is these data just remind us that colonies are more regulated than you expect by the response threshold model. Once you get into these highly used social groups, you're looking at very cohesive units. You're looking at very regulated units. And you can't just use the same models as you used for the origin of sociality. This also, though, tells us something else about colonies. And that's that they're very organized in terms of how they do work. Now, work is task performance, right? So when they do all of these different things, they're doing work. Work is metabolism, right? So if you're an organism and we ask about what kind of work you do, you'd be talking about how your cells contribute to growth, to maintenance, and to reproduction. You can ask the same thing in a colony. How is that colony's work contributing to growth, maintenance, and reproduction? And when you start to do this, you start to think about the colony as a metabolic unit. And so you can ask the question of, well, we know some things about how individuals scale metabolically with size. How does a colony scale metabolically with size? And you can do that by putting colonies into respiratory chambers, like this beautiful picture here, and you can measure their oxygen consumption and CO2 output and get a respiratory quotient and get an idea of what it costs for it to be that colony. And here are some data collected by James Waters in our lab. And he's gotten very interesting data that suggests that colonies scale hypometrically with size in terms of metabolic rate, which means that they scale less than linearly. And their coefficient is actually 0.75 approximately, which is interestingly exactly, or not exactly, but almost exactly the same scaling coefficient that you get in individual organisms. So if you look at individual ants as they scale from smaller to larger across species, you're going to see that they scale less than one, and they have a metabolic rate is going to scale to mass to the 0.75 to 0.79. In these colonies, when we increase the size of the colony, they also scale to mass to the 0.75, basically. Now, James also did a really important control where he took a bunch of ants out of the colony and he put them into a chamber by themselves. So if you take individual ants, put them together in groups in a chamber, they're not in their colony, it's not functional, it's just a bunch of ants, how do they scale? And the answer is they scale linearly. They scale exactly as you would expect. As you increase the number of individuals, increase the mass, you're increasing the metabolic rate proportionally. So you're not getting this sort of cost savings effect if you just put a bunch of ants into a chamber. You're only getting it if you're looking at a functional colony. And here's a chart that James has made of all of the different research that's been done on scaling in ants across species and within species, and it's very consistent. You get this hypometric scaling of ant colonies with size. So this means that these colonies aren't just social groups. They're highly cohesive social groups that are sort of almost acting like an organism, right? We've seen how they regulate division of labor, how they regulate work, how they regulate all kinds of different emergent effects in our social complexity work and that social insect people have done more broadly. And now we see that they actually scale metabolically also. So when we think about transitioning to these large cohesive social groups, we should think about them in terms of the superorganism concept. I think the superorganism concept now is not just a metaphor, it's also a physiological characteristic, right? That you get these large individuals that are functioning together with common goals, common work output, and metabolic scaling that is appropriate to that kind of cohesion. And that's it. I'm going to say thank you to everybody. I've got a bunch of pictures here and a bunch of people that I don't have pictures for. And thank you guys for coming out at 8 o'clock in the morning. And I know that there are some students that may have stayed up all night to get here. So thank you.
Thank you, Jeff, Jennifer, for this wonderful lecture that was really fantastic. On behalf of the International Congress of Entomology, I'd like to give you this.
I get a plaque.
Plaque. Recognition for your participation. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are we getting a picture?
Small talk of appreciation.
Thank you.
And also, I'd like to thank Gene Robinson and Rob Page. They make this recommendation, and now I entirely agree with everything that they said, that this is going
now.
To be a fantastic speaker. I never heard you speak before.
Oh, okay.
I knew you, but I never heard you speak before. So thank you, Gene. That was very kind of you to let us go through this difficult time. I was dealing with the crisis of Julius Hoffman at the airport, traveling to France to record his presentation. When this thing happens and we try to communicate and find a solution, and I'm very grateful for you to agree to do that, for Gene and for to Rob for make the suggestion that end up to be a great one. Thank you very much. Let me remind you again that the Julius Hoffman's lecture, the second part of the lecture, is going to be played in this room from 5:30 to 6, and the entire lecture is going to be played again in the other room, the bigger one, the Valencia, from 5 to 6. 5:30 to 6 in here, just the second part, the entire lecture from 5 to 6 in the other room. Thank you very much for coming, and please keep enjoying the International Congress of Entomology.
And let's get coffee.